Yep, looks good.
Okay. So my name is Andrea Giovannucci. I'm an assistant professor in the Joint Department of Biomedical Engineering at UNC Chapel Hill and North Carolina State University. And my laboratory interest is basically merging computational and physiological methods to understand brain function. Today, I'm going to talk about methods that we are developing to interface with the brain in some way. First, I will introduce a little bit of calcium imaging analysis, and I will give you an extensive tutorial about how to analyze this data, because you know an important part of this NeuroNex workshop is to disseminate technology and actually teach people to use it. On the other hand, I will also show you about methodologies that allow to analyze data that comes from the brain imaging in real time. Okay. I sent you some links about Google Collaboratory. There are three notebooks. Nico yesterday illustrates very nicely how they work. So if you want, you can click and start trying to run them. Depending on your machine or your web browser, you might experience difficulties, I think, in visualization. But you know, try to run all of them. And then I will also go through them during this lecture, but just be prepared with that, okay? Cool. This is the outline, and it's a very ambitious outline, I would say. I would like to introduce some motivation about analysis of brain imaging data, both calcium and voltage imaging, and then start talking about the different aspects of the analysis that one need to perform, especially pre-processing steps, motion correction, source separation. And I will focus on a package that I've been developing for some time that is called Kaiman, okay? Which that is, you know, pretty handy and popular for analyzing calcium imaging data and recently also voltage imaging data, a new algorithm that we call VolPi. And I hope there will be time to show you what I've been up to recently. It's called Fiola, and it's a method that pushes the boundary of online analysis to hundreds of hertz. Okay, because Nico yesterday very nicely introduced the fact that you want to speak with the brain at the appropriate speed, at the speed of brain information processing. And available methods don't allow that type of readout of the activity. So we decided to propose some accelerated algorithm. I don't think we'll have time to go over single photon, so endoscopic imaging data, but please ping me. And there is also, if you want, a Google Colab notebook that I didn't paste here for that type of analysis. But let's, this audience doesn't need a big introduction about fluorescence imaging, but since I am the first one, I'm gonna introduce it very quickly. So some recent advances in microscopy, multiphoton imaging, and protein design, for instance, the genetically encoded calcium indicator, enable us to do something very interesting. Enable us to look into the brain of a living animal, okay, and measure the activity of neurons at single cell resolution. Now, not only we can image and monitor the activity of large neuronal population, but we can also access subcompartmental signal. For instance, this is the cerebellum, and these stripes that you see are dendrites, okay? So you have cases in which you just see the somas at the hippocampus, you can see the dendrites, and you can also see both somatic signal and sometimes processes. What do you do? Normally, if you take one of these donuts, this ring shape, shapes that you find here, and you take the average, okay, of these pixels, you will see a signal that looks like this. This corresponds to the intracellular calcium dynamics. These indicators become brighter when there is an influx of calcium. And you will measure a signal that has a specific shape, but we can, in some sense, relate this calcium activity back to spikes. That is how we go from, let's say, A to Z, A to Z in, let's say, in summer. Consider that the multiphoton imaging, you know, allows you to go into the brain at specific depths and visualize what happens there. So you can optically section the brain to see what happens with these neurons that express this protein. Let's talk about two types of imaging. We have, we introduce multiphoton imaging, but sometimes for different type of constraints, like for instance, you want to image deep in the brain with a green lens, or you want a very large field of view at high speed, you might want to use single photon imaging. Use single photon imaging with calcium. Sorry, I swapped them. This is calcium. Voltage is at the bottom. So this is calcium imaging and this is voltage. You see they are very, very different and both of them are imaged to the similar modality. Unlike two photon imaging, we have a problem. Whereas two photon imaging allow us to just get lights from a specific optical plane, with one photon imaging, we are collecting basically the light that comes from a big chunk of tissue in the Z-axis. Right? So one needs to deal with that. The other two big divisions in the analysis that I would like to introduce is the difference between analyzing in batch. That means I have the full movie available, okay? And I'm gonna try to analyze it. Good, this is a typical scenario that you collected your data, you go home, you sleep, or maybe while you sleep, you let the machine analyze your data. A second and more interesting scenario is what we call an online scenario. Online scenario in which, let's say that I have analyzed maybe 5,000 frames, 4,000 frames. Okay, I have extracted some neurons, and now I want to process this data frame by frame, okay? One frame at a time. And I want both to infer the activity of neurons that I already knew about, but sometimes I might also want to find out if new neurons appear. Okay, this is an interesting modality, both from a practical standpoint, because since it's online, you're processing one frame at a time, and you don't have any problem on how large these data sets are. If you want to process 1 million frames, there is no problem. You can just process 1 million frames because you're only looking one frame at a time, okay? The other important aspect of this type of analysis is that it allows you to perform experiments in real time. You want to know what is the state of the brain at some point, you are able to infer what the activity of each neuron is at a given moment. So this also opens the path to new experimental paradigms. What are the basic requirements? It doesn't matter if we are talking about voltage or calcium imaging, there are a set of universal preprocessing steps that we need to go through. The first is correcting for motions, okay? The brain of an animal that is, for instance, on a treadmill that is head fixed, will move a little bit. It will not move dramatically, but there is a need to correct for this type of motion. Then we have initialization. It depends, of course, on the type of algorithm, but it is normally a necessary step to identify roughly where the neurons are, okay? And what's their spatial extent. And finally, there is also a part in which we try to extract signals from this. From these imaging movies. And it's not trivially taking the average of each of the pixels that are enclosed by a region of interest. Because as you, for instance, might see in this example, often a pixel represents more than one source, okay? So more than one neuron can be, in this case, like three neurons share the same small subset of pixels here. So your problem is not simply segmentation and averaging, but it is called what's a source separation. And we call this step denoising spatial and temporal components, okay? Because what you try to do, you go back and forth and you try to find fantastic, you know, looking time signals, okay? Temporal signals, and also refine your, you know, spatial components so that they allow you to get a better signal at each iterations. We'll see a little bit more in detail what I mean with this. And finally, you need to extract spikes. In some cases, like for calcium imaging, the operation of retrieving spikes from the calcium traces is a very nonlinear transformation. And in general, we are not able really to retrieve faithfully all the spikes. We just get an approximation of the spikes. In the case of voltage imaging, given enough signal to noise ratio, you are able to actually retrieve exactly the spikes as they appear. The spikes as they happen. Okay. Another difference between calcium and voltage imaging is the temporal resolution. Well, in general, we can hope to retrieve spikes at most with a time resolution of, let's say, 30 milliseconds, 20 milliseconds. In this case, your precision can go up to 1 milliseconds at this point. This is an example of why I told you before, this is an example of a small chunk of calcium imaging movies, why you cannot just simply and trivially average the pixels within a region of interest. You would have a lot of contamination of one neuron over the other. Is there any questions so far? Please interrupt me. Don't write on the chat because I will not be able to read. Just abruptly interrupt me and tell me, Andrea, I don't understand this. Or Andrea, what's happening here? Okay, so let's start with motion correction and memory mapping. Let's look at the movie. This is a movie as it's taken from the cortex, the motor cortex of an animal that is running on a treadmill. You see that there is a little bit of movement. Why do we need to motion correct exactly? Well, you think, well, I might just design an algorithm that deals with the fact that it's moving. Well, it's very difficult. Most of the algorithms, or the algorithm that I'm aware of right now, they hypothesize that each pixel will always represent the same location. Yeah, and what happens if you try to track what happens in this pixel, sometimes it contains the neurons, sometimes it doesn't contain the neurons. So when you try to perform your denoising operation, it's gonna be very messy. And we can notice something else here. The movement is non-rigid, right? You see that the brain is compressing. It's not just simply translating. So you can have, you know, different case scenario. This is one that is general enough that incorporates everything that I want to tell today. So what do we do? In order to motion correct, we devised an algorithm that broadly speaking divides the field of view in many squares, motion correct each of them separately. And then what we do, we basically interpolate between the shifts that we found for each of these squares, and we define an overall motion field then that we apply then afterwards on the movie. In the demo that you will see on Google Colab, the important parameters, so I'm gonna point out to you what are the important parameters in this, for this type of analysis. The important parameters are gonna be your spatial resolution. So you want to know what is the number of microns per pixels in your movie. You want to know what's the maximum shifts that you allow. So this is something that you have to guess, okay? But you can do it iteratively. But you want to know roughly what is the maximum amount of movement that you can expect. This is useful both in order to do the algorithm more efficient, but also because it allows to focus on the right global minimum when we find, when you try to extract the peak of the shifts. And then you have something that is called PW_rigid, okay, which tells you whether you want to do a rigid motion correction much, much faster, or a piecewise rigid motion correction, which is the one that I just explained to you, that is lower, but allows to fix this problem of compression, shearing, and shearing. If you are curious, this is a parameter that probably you don't want to change. That is the how big is the patch. In general, we found that our experience is that most of the time you really don't have to change these parameters. You don't have to shift to use these parameters. After motion correcting, what we create is a memory mapped file in F order. Let me explain to you what that is. Okay. You realize that with calcium imaging, we are having larger and larger movies. For instance, we have a zebrafish dataset, which goes up to 1 terabyte. 1 terabyte will probably fill most of your hard drives on your laptop hard drives, okay? So what do we do to analyze this type of data? we cannot load in memory this type of data because it will not fit into our memory. That is normally in the order of, let's say, 16, 32 gigabytes. And if you really are, you know, very rich, you go to 1 terabyte of memory. But just loading the movie, it's not enough. Now you need to do some very powerful operations. So how do you solve this problem? You memory map your files. Memory mapping means that the file is on the hard drive and you can access and make operations on chunks of this array without actually having to load that into memory. Okay, so imagine what's happening here. We have different processes and each of them can go and read portion of the file they're interested in, processing it, okay, and then put it somewhere else. One important parameter of memory mapped file is the direction in which you save your data. You know that your hard drive is linear. You cannot really save information in like a matrix in your hard drive. Your hard drive just saves sequences of numbers. So what happens is that when you save this array, for instance, you will have to decide if you want to save the array in such a way that the values are consecutive in this direction, okay, or they are consecutive in this direction. We call the former option C order and the second option F order. Now, why is this important? It is important because let's say that we saved this file in F order, okay? And these processes start trying try to access these chunks of the data. It's gonna be very, very inefficient, okay? Because it's gonna start, you know, just reading this one, then go there and then read this one and then read this one. So if you imagine what happens with your hard drive, it's continually try to jump to new locations to read this part of the file. Now, instead, if you were clever and you save this in C order, when a process needs to read this chunk of data, it just needs to give the beginning and then read everything until here. Okay? So basically, the way you store this data is very important in terms of efficiency or how to you want to read it and write it. Okay? So let's discuss what we do for motion corrections. In order to optimize motion correction and use, let's say 30, 40 processes, eventually 100 if you are on some high performance computing platform, we divide in chunks our movie in time. So for instance, we take the first 1000 frames and we pass it to one process. The second 1000 frames, we pass to another process. Now we can do this, why? Because we are in some sense memory mapping this movie, okay? So each of these processes will perform a motion correction. We will basically motion correct the data with an algorithm that I'm gonna detail shortly. And each of them will generate a template. What is a template? A template is a very crisp representation of your field of view. Why do you need it? You need it because you are comparing each frame to this template. So if you had an ideal representation of your field of view, okay, super clear and crisp, then you can use it to motion correct the whole movie. And that's exactly what you do. You iteratively take many templates, you generate a master template that is the crispest, and then you continue. So you iterate a couple of times and you converge to a very nicely motion corrected movie. Oh, I don't have the algorithm, sorry. I thought that we don't have time. If you're interested in the algorithms, why do we need a template? At each time step, what do? We compute a normalized cross-correlation. What is a normalized cross-correlation? Basically, is an operation that allows to identify when two images look similar, okay? So you take your original frame, then you take your template, you move around the template a little bit, and you find if there is a lag in space in X and Y, which is optimal, okay? Because that means that this is the best shift that you can use to align your data, to align your frames, okay? So you register by basically computing a cross correlation between the template and each frame, and then you apply the shift that you find out. You are gonna find, you're gonna, and now I have a question for you. What do you think is gonna be the format in which we are gonna save this movie? C order or F order? So we are reading a lot of frames and then we are saving a lot of frames, right? So the luck is that a TIFF file, for instance, natively is already saved in such a way that is easy to read frame by frame. If you ever tried to read a single pixel from a 3 GB TIFF file, you would know what I'm talking about. It's gonna take like 2 hours, okay? Instead, if you want to read a frame, it's very fast. So natively, it's an F order. But after we perform our motion correction, what do you think is the ideal way to save it back into a memory map file, okay? Given that each of the chunk will save independently in this file.
I'm gonna put you back this.
Sorry?
Is it in C order?
C order would be actually very inefficient because, sorry, I'm going back and forth. C order would be, think about it. So this is the C order and it's nice because we are reading, if this is, okay, you are right, they should have given you an information. The information is that pixels is in this direction, okay? And time is in this direction. So normally when you save this type of files, you save it in 2 dimensions, not in 3. It would be X times Y times time. Instead, what you have is number of pixels here, so X times Y, and time here, right? So if you save in C order, that would be very, very good if you want to load a chunk of pixels, right? Because pixels times time. So this is a chunk of pixels. But when we do our motion correction, we are looking at frames, right? We are looking at the first 1,000 frames, the second 1,000 frames, the nth 1,000 frame. So the convenient way to save it is in F order. Because F, remember F, I have this memory, mnemonic rule. F order is frame. So, okay, I remember F frames. And then C is just the other one, okay? C is pixels. But for analyzing the data, so whereas for motion correcting is awesome to have it in F order, for analyzing the data, it actually becomes very complex. You want to be able to load pixel by pixel. And you can probably imagine why. Because you're gonna take a neuron, right? Or what's around the neurons when you want to analyze. You want to take all the movie a few pixels. So in that case, the C order is better. So I have a command that does this for you in a highly parallelized fashion, a highly parallelized way. Okay, so now if you are curious in the Google Colab, you can try to load load this memmap file. Right? You will get YR, you can reshape it, but when you plot what type is it? It will tell you memmap. And you will see 0 increase in your memory. Because you can deal it as in an array, you can sum, you can multiply, you can do whatever you want. And it's gonna be memory mapped. Not in your memory. But you have to pay attention. Because if you start doing some operation that is inefficient given the order, okay, you're gonna wait for a long, long time before the operation is finished. You can try to sum this vector. For instance, if you say images.sum, I don't know how much you guys are familiar with Python, but basically if you want to sum all the elements in this vector, you can say images.sum parentheses, and it will sum everything and it will not load anything in memory. It will just do the sum automatically on the hard drive. Okay. So we are going to save this one in a way that is easy to read pixel wise. And you will understand why now, because I'm going to explain you what is the algorithm that we use. The algorithm that we use to separate the sources, so to perform that famous identification of the signals, we use an algorithm that is called constrained non-negative matrix factorization. And although albeit the name is very, very difficult, the concept is not too difficult. The idea is to represent each movie as the sum of different components, okay? These components will have two natures. Let's say we'll have the spatial, okay, components, which represent the spatial footprint of a neuron. And then you will have the temporal component, which you call C, which represent the temporal dynamics of each of the neurons, okay? So you try to represent Y as the sum of many components, okay, which are mixed spatial and temporal. Plus, you will have some different class, second class citizens, if you want, components, which will represent the background, that is the activity of the neuropil, everything that is not clearly visible as a shape. The mathematical formulation is this one. This is a regression problem, if you want. We are trying to minimize the difference between Y and the sum of these two components. Okay, so I tell you, we represent the movie Y as the sum of these components. And these components, they will have some constraints that will help us to find a better solution. For instance, A is gonna be sparse. What does it mean sparse? It means that the spatial components will be mostly zero, except in a few pixels where the neuron is, right? This is gonna be true most of the time, but not true for these components, right? In this case, the spatial component will not be sparse. And then we have another one that is non-negativity, okay? And this is easy to understand. Why do you want non-negativity? You want to non-negativity because first you assume that the signal of calcium is positive, which is, you know, true most of the time, let's say so. And the second one is that your spatial footprint is positive, okay? And this is also pretty much true if you think about it, because, you know, can you have a negative contribution of fluorescence? You cannot, right? The fluorescence will always contribute positively. So you cannot have a negative weight here. Yeah? So this nice optimization problem can be solved, okay, efficiently, but it's kind of computationally challenging. Let me be a little bit more specific about what we mean by this decomposition, okay? So first, as I told you before, we represent the movies number of pixels times number of frames, so just two dimensions. Then this is the decomposition that I discussed with you. And just to be more explicit, you can decompose each of the components with the outer product, okay, of the spatial component and the temporal component. If you don't know what outer product is, means it's just a type of matrix multiplication, which very nicely, okay, and you can see it here on the right, will give you just the contribution of that component to your movie, okay? That's the way you separate the signals of everybody. These algorithms, by compressing the activity of neurons in this very economical, with this very economical representation, automatically also helps to separate different components. And while this is sparse, yep, please.
I have a question about two slides ago about the memory mapping.
Sure.
Yeah. So the F order is in frames, which is essentially in the temporal component, and C order is in pixels. And those are the two axes that you just mentioned two slides ahead. So for memory mapping, when you're doing the motion correction, it makes sense to, so what you were saying was that for memory mapping, in the process of doing the motion correction, it accesses the file in F order because you want it to go frame by frame, right? But it saves it in C order, is that it?
No, it saves before, it saves it in F order, because think about it. You can see this diagram as these processes are reading, okay?
Yeah.
But you can also see these processes are writing. So what if you want to put together now a huge file of 100 gigabytes, okay? You don't want to save it in memory and then do dot save, right? What you want to do is say, no, okay, I'm gonna save chunk by chunk. Mm-hmm. And when you save, it's also important that you maintain the right order, because—
You
understand me? But the question is
that— You need to keep it in the right order in time. So it accesses and saves it in F order.
Exactly. But then the F order is bothering you in the next phase of the algorithm. So you transform into C.
Okay.
And you do this very, very efficiently, meaning that you you do it in parallel. You again get many processes. Each of them is going to read a little bit, okay, and then save in the big file. So also it takes very little, you know.
Okay, thank you.
Depending on the file size, but no, that's a good question. Very good question. Thanks. It is clear the representation at this point, you know, and I was ending up telling you that the same can happen with the, come on, sorry, just got stuck. Yeah, of course. Let's see if I can recover this thing. Something is very slow now. Take long. So basically in the meanwhile, that's all. Sorry, I don't know what's happening with my computer right now. It's just very slow. But let me close some stuff because I think this is too much. I'm gonna try to.
Andrea.
Sorry. Yeah.
If I may, is there a reason why the residual B is time dependent, and like something that would explain it? Is that like fluctuation in laser power, or
no? It's the neural pill. So okay. Basically, imagine that there is a lot of activity that you don't capture. Imagine that, you know, there's a lot of processes that go around. Okay, and often it happens, you know, in the brain. Mm-hmm. You know, if you look at a reasonably small patch, that, you know, there is an event and a lot of these processes light up. And when many of them light up, you still start seeing them in your focal plane.
This model, you assume that those are not spatially dependent. They basically create a variation on the baseline.
Absolutely.
Background image. Would it help to set B to 1? Because there might be localization information in there that,
like, what do you mean set to 1?
Well, wait, B is equal to 1 all the time? Sorry, F.
No. F is this, see? You can see it here.
Got it.
So it also changes. And normally you can have more than one of these components, right? If you have, let's say, maybe one patch that does something and the other patch that does something else, you can have multiple of them.
Got it. No further question.
Awesome. So that's a very good question. Here you can see a little bit what it looks like. You can see that there is sometimes, you know, it's lighting up the background. You see that? Everything. And that's capturing exactly that thing. Okay. So this is the raw movie.
Right. I have one question, Andrea. This is Darcy. Yeah. I'm just interrupting since you said I could do it abruptly. I'm taking advantage of your words. In relation to the background, though. Oh, I mean, in this model, we describe the background the royal we as a single component, but right, there's no reason it couldn't be, in a sense, multiple components as well. Yeah. So if you wanted a background, just to let people know, it doesn't have to be a single component. It can be anything you want, number of components. The algorithm, in a sense, treats it the same way, except you may not have a spatial constraint or other. You may change some of the details of the constraints, but the background isn't forced to be a single component. So, you know, if he shows it like this, it can be very general.
It can be general. The only, so the way that we, you know, we are royal again, because we think about it is it should be low rank, okay? And it is a very general term. It just means, look, if you start adding a lot of these background components, pay attention, you'll start absorbing the signal of the neurons, right? Because it's a signal that you let roam free. And, you know, this is an assumption on the background, right? It's a big assumption. Nico said, well, why it's really fixed in time, you know, in space, and it's a block. It's really true. And, you know, and also, you know, Darcy say, yeah, there can be multiple, and then we don't know how many. And when you see, when you do one photon, this is going to be even more messy. This stuff is not even true in one photon. So this again is a modeling assumption that might hold or might not, as in, you know, many times in computer science. Okay, And so I just wanted to show you this movie, which is which show you the reconstructed. You take the raw movie, okay? Then you can reconstruct the movie with all the components, A, C, and B, and F, or you can reconstruct the movie just using the neurons, okay? So you basically take out the background. And then you can see very, very clearly what happens with these neurons when you remove the background. This the residual, which is basically removing this movie from this one. If you did well your work, this should mostly look like white noise. And you see there is, it's not really white noise. You can see small things here and there, okay? So it's not open. Why? Because it's a model, right? And there are some assumptions that are violated, but you know, in broad approximations, we think we're doing a reasonable job. And this is the output in terms of spatial components and temporal components that you get. Okay, so how do we do that? We looked at motion correction. Yep.
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay. Hey, I just got a quick question about the motion correction before you move on to the online stuff. Let's say, like offline, you've performed motion correction, just one iteration, and you find that there's still some motion that you see by eye. Does it benefit the data at all to run it through motion correction yet again or multiple times?
In general, yes. But if you run this algorithm once, that's already going through two iterations and it fails, there's something else that needs to be fixed. So if you tell me, if I ran Kaiman and there was still some residual motion, and you tell me, can I run it again? Rarely it's beneficial. It's more likely that there is some other issue. And there is a set of issues that I can tell you. You know, the most classical issue is that in your image, there is something that is a fixed reference. Example, sometimes, you know, in light sheet data, you see some horizontal lines that are fixed. It doesn't matter what happens or, you know, to the fish that moves. You will always have these horizontal lines. That's a problem because these horizontal lines will become a reference for your motion correction algorithm. So what you need to do in this case, for instance, is not trying to run it multiple times. Will not be useful. You need to, you know, for instance, do Fourier transform, remove the high frequency, these specific frequencies, okay, horizontal frequencies, and now run motion correction again. So Charles, we can talk later. If you tell me exactly what is the issue, I can tell you. Because once this fails, it's more likely that there is some underlying issue more than repeating the motion correction. Because we already repeated a couple of times.
Cool, thanks.
No problem. So we discussed this first part, okay? And we're already at 11:42, so we're going really slow. But it's good. I prefer that you understand that we go in depth. That we see many things. The second part is how do we initialize these algorithms? This algorithm that we saw, it's a negative matrix factorization algorithm. You know, it's a very powerful method, but optimizing it is actually a non-convex problem, okay? Which leads to an issue that is when you try to find a solution, will most of the time end up in local minima, okay? So you need to provide very good initialization to this algorithm in order to work well. So we're gonna see how do we do that. We discussed the fact that, you know, loading in memory a 1 terabyte movie is not really feasible. So how do we decompose a field of view? If you think about solving the problem of finding neurons in this little square, okay, and in this big square, you'll find that it's actually the same problem, right? And the only difference, if you want, would be the borders of these little patches. Okay? Think about it, solving the problem here, solving the problem on this big patch, it's gonna be the same thing if you don't consider the borders. And that's exactly what we do. We solve the problem in little squares that we call patches, and then we merge everything together, taking into account, sorry, trying to solve problems at the border. This is a depiction of the way we access this memory map file, although it's in 3D, you know, I told you that it's in 2D, but you know, for the sake of representation, what we do is the following. We load different, you know, subtensors of this 3D tensor, okay? and we pass them to different CPUs. Each of them will just load this little chunk. We'll process it. We'll find their proper initialization, okay? And once we've done everything, we merge everything together back, taking into account how to solve problems at the border. This is the parameters that you're gonna use in the Google Colab file that I shared with you. P equal one is about deconvolution, which I'm not gonna deal with today in details, but if you're interested, I can tell you. The rule of thumb is gonna be, you use P equal one if you have a fast indicator if the imaging rate is low with respect to the rise time of the calcium indicator, okay? So for instance, GCAMP6F is fast, you image at 30 Hertz, you are good with P equal one. But if you image at 30 Hertz and you're using GCAMP6S, GCAMP6S will not raise immediately, okay? It will take some time to reach the maximum. So you're gonna use P equal two. I'll be happy to discuss with you in details this if you want offline. GMB is the number of background. As Darcy mentioned, you know, the number of background doesn't need to be one. In this case, for instance, it's two. In general, we use one or two. I don't know if Darcy, you ever used three and you were so, you know, brave to
a
do
bazillion.
So.
A bazillion. I have to.
So, normally one or two, three, if you want, or a gazillion, if it might work. Merge threshold is a threshold that tells you what's the level of correlation between neurons to merge them, okay? So this is a parameter for you. Why? Think about that you're photostimulating, okay? If you're photostimulating, you're artificially generating a high correlation between neurons. So when you analyze, if you let this number to be too low, you will merge a lot of neurons, the one that you photostimulate at the same time. So what you want to keep is normally is something between 0.85 and 0.95. 0.85 if you have neurons that are not really correlated in general, and you increase this threshold if you're into your photostimulating. These are the size of the patches, okay? How big are these patches? Apologies. How big are these patches and how much overlap there's between them? I tend not to touch this parameter. The one that I tend to touch is this. This is the number of neurons that you expect to find in the patch, okay? For instance, if you're, you know, in this scenario, okay, at most I would say you will have six neurons, right? So at most, okay? So you have to think about the at most. So I would have a K equal six. And how do I do this? Normally, I just take the average, I look at the neurons, and I make an approximation about that, okay? Same for this G-sig step. This is the half size of your neuron, right? If your neuron is 10 pixel, this should be five, right? If your neurons have specific different sizes in two dimensions, X and Y in particular, then you can have two different numbers. And normally, you don't touch these other parameters, okay? So this is the way you initialize your, we initialize using patches, okay? And then there is a second step in which we refine. Why do we need to refine? Because we said, at most I can find six components, right? The algorithm will find six components for you, okay? Now, half of them will be crap. So what do? You go here and you try to clean up automatically the components that are spurious. And you have different metrics to do so, okay? One is we call the signal-to-noise ratio, okay? Which is, you know, basically, without getting into the details, is how large is the maximum transient, okay? This RVAL threshold, it's how crisp, if you want, is the spatial component. And finally, we have a convolutional neural network that has been trained to identify what looks like a neuron and what looks like something else. And something else might even be, you know, something like this, okay? Or this, puncta, which are still carrying very nice signal, okay? But they are not somas. So we train this network and we have different parameters here to set. This is the minimum signal to noise ratio that is acceptable to add the component. This is the minimal threshold in crispness that is acceptable. This is the minimum. No, sorry. Let me rewind. This is not a mistake. This every component that has at least this value will be accepted. Okay, for these three, at least these values. Whereas this one tells you that everything that has a probability of looking like a neurons less than 0.1 will be just thrown out. So pay attention, okay? Because this is being trained on 11 data sets, which might or not, or might not represent your data. So you want to be, you know, playing a little bit with this if you have troubles because it's excluding too much neurons. Example, this is after initialization, your movie will look something like that, okay? If we refine it, we'll find these components, okay? So automatically, without touching anything, you know, I think the algorithm has done a reasonably good job in identifying the components that look okay. Not perfect, but okay. Okay, I would say, can we do breakout room, Ryan?